Hey, this is Tim Pierce. This video is a celebration of an old 335 and the surprising amount of tones you can get out of it just by changing your approach with your fingers, pick velocity, the volume knobs, the tone knobs, the gain structure of your amp, the pickup selector switch, and finally, some effects while you're playing. We're also going to get a short history lesson on this guitar from Keith Williams of 5-Watt World. And then our featured guitarist is Lyle Workman. He has a brand new solo album, and he hired a symphony in London to join him on his tracks. Click the link below if you want to check out the online masterclass.
My divided by 13 right here is gained up, but it's the kind of amp that has a pretty simple circuit, and if you pick softly or use your fingers, it's sort of a clean sound. You have all this range from just how you touch the guitar, whether you're touching it softly or striking it really hard. So I'm going to hit it hard for a second and show you just the most gained up sound. Now, if I switch from the bridge pickup to the neck pickup and play softly with my fingers, you get a pretty cool clean tone. So by varying my pick velocity with a tone like this, there's so many places I can live in between the two extremes. And this is what I do most of the time I'm soloing. Let me demonstrate. Neck pickup. Middle. Bridge. Now, more importantly, I use pick velocity to punctuate phrases. To me, that's the strongest way to make a statement. There I'm exaggerating, but you get the effect. Here's a phrase where I start out picking hard and end up ramping down to a soft picking. Now I'll do the opposite, start soft, ramp up to hard. Now, because I use a lot of hammer-ons and pull-offs in my routine, the pick becomes the punctuator really the whole time. I'm going to exaggerate a little bit more over a track where it really counts and use a few of these tools. I'm going to stick with the neck pickup for now. So that was quite a bit of range on the neck pickup. If I switch to the bridge, I get an additional level of gain. And that's without changing anything on the pedal or the amp. It's the parameters from most clean with the neck pickup and fingers to most aggressive and dirty, picking as hard as I can with the bridge. So the actual extremes are pretty wide. The bridge pickup with the volume all the way up and the tone all the way up. For the solos on this video that I played, I did something different. It's a trick that guitarist Jeff McElhane taught me. If you take the tone knob on the bridge pickup and turn it down to 5, it gives the bridge pickup more sweetness, takes away a lot of the harshness, takes away thinness, and makes it more balanced with the other two pickups when you switch around. As I said, I used it for every solo in this video, and I think it really works. When I do a solo, I usually just choose one sound and roll. Maybe you're the same way. For this, I tried something different. The 3 UA pedals are on a button under my foot, so I can turn on and off wetness. Now, this is essentially the same as simply stepping on an effect on your pedal board, but what's different is I went phrase by phrase. I would do a dry phrase or a pair of dry phrases and then a wet phrase. I did this at the intro to this video, and I'm going to do it again now to show you something that I kind of forget sometimes, that you can actually activate an effect and kind of enjoy it just sporadically in a performance.
Now we're going to hear from Keith Williams. He's a friend of mine, kind of helps me with advice on my YouTube channel. He has a great channel of his own called 5-Watt World. Does these great histories of instruments. You got to check it out. The link is below. He's going to tell us a little bit about the history of the 335.
Gibson revealed the 335 to dealers in the company's magazine, the Gibson Gazette, in February of 1958. The headline announced, a new ES-335T Spanish guitar. The standard sunburst finish listed for $267.50, and the natural or blonde finish was $282.50. By the time 1960 rolled around, Gibson had a success on their hands. The 335 sold about 500 units, and the more expensive 345 and 355 were each selling about 300 units. B.B. King had played Gibsons in the 40s, Fenders and Gibsons in the 50s, and by the 60s, he'd settled into playing a 335 with a Bigsby tailpiece and the custom order stereo wiring and Veritone switch. By 67, King had moved on to the upscale 355, still with the Bigsby, stereo wiring, and Veritone. The high-end model suited King, who was by then blues royalty. Other famous bluesmen settled on the 335 family guitars as well. Freddie King had played a Les Paul, gold top, in the 50s. But by the early 60s, he too was playing a 345, then later a 355. His choice of that cherry red 355 would send Eric Clapton clamoring to get one of his own as soon as he had the means and the opportunity. Eric Clapton bought his 64 335 in November of 1968. Guitarist Jerry Donahue, an American transplant to London at the time, was working the counter at the Selmer store in Charing Cross Road the day Clapton came in to find a 335. He remembers, it was one of my main highlights of working at Selmer's. You can imagine my amazement and joy later as I sat watching Cream come out at the Albert Hall, Eric with the 335 strapped on. He played that guitar for the entire evening. Eric Johnson owns a 64 cherry red 335 that, per his own comments, was inspired by Clapton's influence. Famously, Eric recorded his Grammy-winning Cliffs of Dover almost entirely with that 335.
So this is my player grade 1963 ES-335. It was greatly reduced in value by modifications. It had a refret, which I love. The pickups were not original. And this originally has a Bigsby because there are holes back here. So I got lucky and got this guitar for a really low price. I had put new pickups in. I had Ron Ellis new pickups in. They went into one of my favorite Les Pauls. So it was a sacrifice, but now I put Tyson Tone pickups in. I really like these too. I love new pickups. The guys who bring this vintage aesthetic forward, I just have great luck with brand new pickups, even in an old guitar, and these are no exception. I think they sound great. So this guitar is not original, but the neck is one of the best necks I've ever felt on a 335, old or new. The reason I bought this guitar, I picked it up at Norm's 2 years ago, and when I felt the neck, I knew, because I picked up a lot of these my whole life. It's been hard for me to find a good 335, but this neck fit my hand. It had a great refret. And I still feel that way. It's so easy for me to play. It stays in tune. So many advantages to a player guitar because the player who owned this worked out all the bugs and made it work.
I want to introduce you guys to Lyle Workman. You might remember Lyle. We had him on the Pete and Tim show a couple of years ago. At this point, he's a pretty established composer, and you're about to see a list of his great movies in about a minute. But he was also a working guitar player for a long time. Played with Frank Black for a long time, Beck, Sting, lots of people. He did lots of sessions too. He and I were kind of knocking around doing sessions together in the 90s. Anyway, Lyle has a new record called Uncommon Measures. I love to see people think big, and it's kind of breathtaking what he did. And so check it out. And what's really breathtaking is the way his fingers work on the guitar.
Thanks for watching. If you haven't subscribed yet, please hit the subscribe button and ring the bell. If you are a subscriber, please ring the bell. It lets us let you know every time a new video is released. You can also support us by clicking the link below for the online masterclass. As I always say, we're up to over 100 hours of lessons and content, over 1,000 videos. There's a 14-day free trial. Take your time, take a long look. We'd love to have you join us.